Yeah, welcome. Welcome very, very much to Conversation. A pleasure to welcome to the program two wonderful ladies who are involved with an organization that is the Association for Trauma Outreach and Prevention, or the acronym O-T-O-P, O-T-O-P.
ATOP.
ATOP. Sorry. I'm very sorry. On my far right is Jhnanne Winchester, old friend of mine. She's the UN representative of the organization. And on my immediate left is Annie Kalayjian, and she's the founder and the president of the organization and a person who understands trauma in a way that we could all learn from and so forth. And welcome very, very much to Conversation.
Thank you for inviting us.
Well, our pleasure. We'll be talking with you, but maybe we could start with you. You could kick it off, as they say. We got a couple clips we're going to show. But could you share your own personal background, born and raised a little bit, and just to get a little grounding, family, education, that. And then we'll get on to the discussion of the thing that your organization is involved with. But your own background personally, please.
Thank you so much, Harold. Mm-hmm. Yes, I was born in Syria because my father was a survivor of the Ottoman Turkish Genocide, and his parents had to go through months of in the Arabian desert to make it to what's called Kilis, from Kilis, which is in Turkey now, to a place called Azez, which is in Syria. That's the exact area that the conflict is happening now between the president, the government, and the opposition in Syria.
Is that part of the Arabian desert?
The desert is between Turkey and Syria.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, there is a large...
I didn't know that.
Yes, there is a large desert there, definitely.
Okay.
And I went to elementary school there, and the 2 years in high school, and then we, as a family, moved to Fort Lee, New Jersey, where I finished my high school, and from there received my master's and doctoral degrees at Teachers College, Columbia University.
I see. Okay, family. Armenian, the Armenian business is something that has been covered up by a lot of people. They see it that way. And maybe it's worth sharing. And also, it's very trauma-producing, and you're concerned with trauma.
Yes.
And these effects of, well, there was the Nazi Holocaust against the Jewish people,
yes,
as you understand. But understand that. So maybe brief touching on the fact that you're a descendants of that very, very genocidal kind of treatment of your people in the early 20th century. Maybe it's worth mentioning.
Yes, 1.5 million were killed. And
that's a lot of people.
And left. Some of them were beaten to death in the deserts, and some were thrown in the river. And we just watched the documentary at the UN, which is called River Ran Red. And it's addressing the, it's a documentary on a survivor who documented what he went through as an Armenian survivor. So it is something that moved me to be passionate about this work and to make sure that the trauma is transformed to healing and people learn the lesson so we don't repeat it. Because we didn't learn it with the Armenian genocide, and then Holocaust happened, 1915, yes.
Yeah, 15,
and then Holocaust, and then the Cambodian, and then Rwandan. You know, there are four genocides only in April.
Mm-hmm.
April is the bloodiest month, as T.S. Eliot had said, and both Cambodian Holocaust and Armenian genocide and Rwandan are all in April.
Why do we say that there's the Holocaust is, if the term comes of Holocaust, it's always assumed to be the Jewish situation. Wasn't it a Holocaust in your case? Why do you differentiate between a Holocaust and a genocide?
Oh, that's a very interesting question. I think because the genocide word was not even founded until 1945 with the UN and Raphael Lemkin. So before that, Armenians used mass Holocaust. In Armenian, the word medyeren means the same as Holocaust, but it wasn't the Holocaust word was not used for Armenians. I'm not sure why. They called it the deportations, the atrocities, mass trauma, genocide after Raphael Lemkin.
It's important to Raphael Lemkin. Who's Raphael Lemkin?
Raphael Lemkin is the Jewish scholar who started named it as genocide. Genocide. Mm-hmm. And then from there, the convention of genocide was adopted by the UN so that any kind of act, in part or in whole, to kill nations because of their religious, nationality, or culture is now a crime, or mm-hmm. it has been since 1945.
For 97 years,
it's been denied by U.S. government and the Turkish government. There are about 30 nations from 189 or 200 now mm-hmm. countries in the world, there are 30 nations that have acknowledged and accepted it. So my work is to try to help my community mm-hmm. and other genocides and even incest or rape victims whose perpetrators not necessarily come forward. They are always denying mm-hmm. their atrocities. Mm-hmm. My attempt is to help the surviving community to find their own validation and acknowledgement, connect with those nations that have acknowledged it, so not to wait and put on hold their healing process. See, if you don't really address your trauma and come to a healing place, then you are, it's like an open wound. You are always oozing and bleeding at all times.
I wonder.
And recreating in some
trauma.
Strange kind of way.
Recreating?
Yes.
The people that had been victimized by it or had survived it?
Survived it.
That's a very interesting, it's a very awesome thing to consider.
It's like a tape that runs inside, and you keep broadcasting, even if you never open your mouth about it, your emotional waves that come out from you, the way you create your life coming from this trauma keeps recreating. Eventually, it's a community-wide situation.
Yeah.
She's going to Palestine at the end of the month by invitation, and that's a whole case history classic
to do
example.
More on forgiveness workshop.
Forgiveness is another, they have reconciliation,
yes. So,
and all these kind of terms. I know, I have James Joyce had Daedalus say at one point, history is a nightmare.
Mm-hmm.
I believe
from which
you
we
could
need
add,
to wake up.
Mm-hmm. From which I'm attempting to awaken.
Mm-hmm.
History. Now, what I'm thinking back through history, how do we identify? We've always lived and still do in an unjust world in terms of the whole of human society. So there's trauma all over, even individually. At an individual level, there are things that cause people to be very, very, very vindictive and prejudicial against other members of a human society. And I'm just wondering about it systemically, because if you think of the Amerindian peoples of North America and South America, or the Western Hemisphere, by European invaders from Europe, it was a Holocaust mm-hmm. delivered down on them by Europeans. And in general, the means by which the world has organized itself is through conquest by the strong over the weak. Is that not the case? It's a general thing that we can see. Realpolitik still holds. Whoever's got the weapons can control, conquer, rape, do whatever they want. They're above the law in a certain sense.
And the weapons can be guns or machetes or baseball bats or stones, but it can also be propaganda machine.
Are you talking about the weapons of the strong? I'm talking about the weapons of the strong who have the ability. The Armenians were able to be treated that way because the other side was more powerful in terms of weapons.
But if you can control people.
And they could use their prejudice against a group rather than the group that's being, or let's say the slaves that came in the Middle Passage.
But
they
so Harold,
are a civilization that is not as developed or as Rome.
Harold? So there are various ways to control people and to dominate people,
mm-hmm.
using weapons and violence, using gender games, using propaganda of one sort or another.
Absolutely.
Media.
Thank you, Mr. Goebbels.
Media, right?
Uh-huh.
Using things like red and circuses and sports, and then so on and so forth. So, but we have an opportunity, which is
not to mention co-option.
Exactly.
Yes.
And
okay.
banking systems and uh-huh. the money system, rather than building community based on the way nature produces wealth. Things that we talk about with what Bucky Fuller saw. Mm-hmm. So we have an opportunity, and the UN system is about the opportunity to create a new planetary reality.
Uh-huh, you think so?
Yes, but what I think Dr. Kalayjian's work is about that's mm-hmm. so important is that there are tried and true methods, tools, intentions for the healing from the old programming of our brains and our souls and our hearts. To be afraid, to project what we don't want. They say worry is prayer for things you don't want.
Okay.
Worry is prayer for things you don't want. Yeah. So Dr. Kalayjian has worked with some of the very finest results that have been found in her science of healing and mental health.
Is that dealing with the people who have been oppressed, or is it dealing with the people who did the oppression? How do we deal with this instance, a world of such disparity in terms of power in the world, economic power, political power, persuasive, advertising, all the, such an unequal world of power relationships where one can conquer another? Mm-hmm. And how does an advanced civilization deal with civilizations that are not as advanced? How do we deal with this whole question?
All right.
Is
so
something
how do we do
I'm
that?
Interested
that's,
in.
That's why now we are going to DR, Democratic Republic of Congo. We were there last year.
Really? Terrible.
And that's another terrible area where the Europeans and others are coming and exploiting them. And their own government has sided with them, and the government takes the benefits from the mining and other minerals that they have, the benefits, and they keep it for themselves, their personal use, while the public is dying of malaria, typhoid, and basic.
It's more or less a pattern for the whole world.
It is a pattern.
Indeed.
Okay, it's a pattern for the whole world. The world is not just. Or there is no just order. It's just totally unjust for the rich and the powerful.
So how can we
So in that world, so we don't accept the world, you're dealing mostly with the people who are oppressed.
Right.
Okay, you're not worried so much about the reconciliation with the people who maybe can begin to start seeing some sense or something, or, you know, stop the oppression.
We have approached the Al-Qaeda when I was in northern Pakistan. We made several attempts to negotiate and talk with them, but there was a whole politics about it because our Pakistani colleagues were indignant because they asked that the women will come to the meeting covered.
Uh-huh. Yeah.
And they refused to be covered, which this is the same problem we had in Lebanon.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. The Hezbollah wanted all the women to be covered to come to the meeting.
Nasrallah?
Hezbollah.
I know, but Nasrallah is in Lebanon.
Yes.
Yeah.
So
is he of that thing? I mean, he has a great influence in Lebanon.
He does.
Yeah. Is he one who wants the women? It seems like a throwback. The attitude toward women is so ridiculous.
It is.
It impoverishes the culture, half of your
culture. Seems that way to me. Half the world is just, you know. So how do you deal with people who are so entrenched in backward notions and culturally inherited institutions out of a nightmare of injustice, which we call history? How do we deal with that? I guess that's what you're involved with in your organization.
We're working on transforming these historical injustices because they are impacting us now, even though we are not in DR Congo or Haiti or Palestine, mm-hmm. but here, even in our comfort of our homes, mm-hmm. because energetically and through our emotional DNA, mm-hmm. we are finding ourselves that we are impacted by it. So we have a whole curriculum to transform, and also we have a meditation.
Okay.
Here it is, From War to Peace.
Let me hold it up. This is a DVD, From War to Peace, Transforming Generational Trauma. Generational trauma could be, I had a friend of mine, I don't even give his name now, but he's a friend of mine who was a survivor. He's older now, of course. He was a survivor of both Belsen and Auschwitz, through the whole worst thing. He said at the end, he had to admit, he's now, actually I'll tell you, this Leslie Schwartz. And he said, he's been in Germany, they're making a major film for national television there about him, and he's trying to do reconciliation. He said, but at the end there, one of the things that they lost completely, and they had to admit it, they lost any capacity for empathy at all. Nothing mattered about anybody else. Which is, empathy is one of the big generic things that we talk about when we're talking about the most important emotional relationships and feelings of
yes,
people.
Yes, and also for healing.
So anyway, against
for
that,
healing. Oh, I'm glad you mentioned empathy, because that's our third step in our seven-step healing model.
Yeah.
And also, you asked about Harry Stack Solomon earlier.
Yes,
He's the one who says, without empathy and validation, and even reparation. Like
reparation?
Yeah, like Germany paid the to the survivors.
No reparation. Mr. Randall, I forget his name. There's no reparation for the slavery of the slaves in North America.
Yes,
there's no reparation being considered. Oh, don't even think about that.
Yes.
They get off. If you're powerful, if you're the winner, you don't have to be worrying about the law. You do what the hell you want.
That's the unfortunate, the warpedness in our justice system that needs to be slowly transformed. I think the judicial system needs to be transformed.
Anyway, let me let him see this, if you don't mind. And just take your time, Josh. Come in on that. Yeah, they're coming in. You can see on the monitor. So they come in, and it's from War to Peace, transforming generational trauma into healing, ancestral healing meditation by yourself. Mm-hmm. So this is a DVD that you have.
It's a CD. It's an audio.
Oh, it's a CD. Mm-hmm. And so it's there.
And you see the chapters there. It starts with the original sin, like in the Bible that says that we were thrown out of the heaven.
Paradise, right?
And how even a young baby is born is considered guilty until they're baptized.
Don't go into religion with me.
No,
all religions.
It is in our collective unconscious.
Yes.
We need to address it on some level. I'm not saying I believe in it. I'm just saying that that's where you need to start.
Yeah, right.
To undo. Mm-hmm. Because it has gone into our psyche.
Because people get programmed from the moment they're born in the womb. There's vibrational programming that's going on. There's out-of-the-mouth programming. There's discipline.
What's out-of-the-mouth programming?
I mean, people will say things.
Oh, word-of-mouth.
Word-of-mouth.
Oh, yeah, right.
Speaking concepts, speaking belief systems that create imprinting that then create
imprinting
these emotions.
Imprinting is very important,
right.
Yeah.
You mentioned empathy. Well, there's an empathetic center in the brain and in the heart brain. And when that
what heart brain?
There's they know now in science that there is like a brain that is a part of our heart organ as well.
Now the heart is a pump. It pumps blood. It's not a brain. Brain is in your head.
We'll have to bring you some proof about this for the next conversation.
That's another
topic.
Well,
I think that's a myth. I don't know why. The heart is a muscle.
Well, you're allowed to have that belief system.
Let's focus more on what you said, empathy, because Harry Stack Solomon, as I mentioned earlier, he mentioned that there's no healing from trauma if one does not have empathy, validation, and reparation. Mm-hmm. That would be the ideal situation. Uh-huh. And when someone is traumatized, you said there are a lot of people who can't empathize. Because what happens when
he said at the time.
Right.
You could not care about anybody but your survival.
Right.
And when you're put in that kind of a position, that's beaten out of you and you can't even think. The person's dying, you can't think. You can't.
Because what happens when trauma strikes, our connection to the group, to the rest of the collective unconscious is torn. Mm-hmm. And what happens, you therefore have this tunnel vision that you can't see but your own pain.
Yeah.
You can't feel but your own pain. Your pain is so immense that it's impossible for you to be able to open up and have this kind of panoramic view, acknowledging what other people are going through.
Exactly.
And then perhaps having empathy. Mm. So that's why our focus is on healing first.
Mm-hmm.
Let's heal people. Mm-hmm. Let's care about the wounds that they've been carrying for generations, and then they'll be able to be in that healthy place.
You think they're passed on like engrams or something?
Yes,
exactly.
Yes, exactly.
Wilhelm Reich.
That's exactly how.
Yeah.
So okay. See, some of it
you
is
think
about
it is. It's inherited at
yes.
a physical level?
Yes.
The pain of the trauma?
Yes, absolutely. Indeed.
I'm not familiar with that, but that's really something. It is the sins of the fathers will be delivered down, or the trauma of the fathers mm-hmm. will be delivered down on the trauma yes. of the sons and
yes,
daughters?
Yes, yes.
Okay, exactly. That's very...
well, so we have research showing
okay,
the,
well, then
this transmission.
There are certain groups
and
saying...
And certain, Harold, certain traditional cultures and indigenous cultures recognize these things. Their medicine people could see the trauma in people and they knew how to lift it out. Our science-based culture in the Western world is only coming back around full circle to all of that because we have ways now with brain scans and other yeah. kinds of scanning of the system to see where trauma lives and how it affects cells and atoms in the body and then creates certain types of illnesses. So this mm-hmm. is a vast topic.
Yeah, sure.
But I think really helpful to understand some of how Dr. Kalayjian's organization and these missions that she takes to train mental health and other kinds of health teachers and professionals uh-huh. in other countries mm-hmm. can begin to broaden the wave of this. And part of the work that I'm developing with Dr. Kalayjian and the yeah. organization is to be able to do some of this work through online learning, distance mm-hmm. training
yeah,
programs.
Yeah, it's wonderful, isn't it?
See, the
like
technology
yes.
yeah. does mediate and empower uh-huh. transformation at
yeah.
a level.
Right. Okay. I've been ranting and everything because I don't know much about it. But let's do go there then. One of the things we got to do, we only got time, we're limited in time, we got an hour, okay? So as you brought a DVD and you brought a couple of DVD mm-hmm. clips in, a couple, 3 minutes long or something like that. So maybe Josh in the control room, you could set it up, and you've got one from this base Sierra Leone.
Right.
And then another one in
Haiti.
Haiti. Mm-hmm. So I think maybe we could set up the DVD, which
sure.
will speak for itself. It runs about 2 or 3 minutes.
And just yeah. but let her mention a little of the background about what the conditions were in Sierra Leone.
Okay,
when
do.
You went there.
And then get
and
it
then
ready. Yeah, what you set it up, as
yes,
they say.
Yes.
You were involved in it, set it up. And
yes.
Was that at the time of the real deep trouble? It was horrible.
It
was going
post.
On in,
post-war, quote-unquote,
yeah.
but the whole
so what year
environment,
what year?
2009.
2009, oh, well, okay.
That's where
so
it was after.
Yeah.
This is the footage that you will see now.
It's
2009.
After the worst of it,
yes,
of
but
the actual activity, yeah.
Yes,
it was
but
horrible.
Believe it or not.
Michael Kagan was so upset, remember.
I know, but yeah. let me tell you.
Yeah,
believe it or not, they said it felt to us as if the war was just ended a week ago.
I see.
It
okay.
wasn't really apparent.
And you went there with the UN team or something?
With
or?
Our team,
yeah.
Meaningful World ATOP team.
Yeah, uh-huh.
There are two things that you have in this life that you won't go wrong: education and respect. If you have those two things, you can go anywhere. What did I say again?
Education and respect.
Okay.
Working with Miss Judith, we always wanted to come here to help Sierra Leone, especially after 13 years of war that really affected you all in terms of physically, emotionally, psychologically. Our goal is to come and to learn from you, to find out what are your needs, and to generate more interest in America so we can send more teams to come here on a regular basis.
Who is Obama?
President of
Kenya, that's right, from Kenya. He is part African. Who's going to be the president of Sierra Leone in this group? Can a woman be the president of Sierra Leone?
Yes.
Okay, so.
So we're going to put it together. This is how it sounds. Listen first, and then it'll be your turn.
listen. Heart snap, clap, heart, heart snap, clap. Your turn.
Heart snap, clap, heart snap.
Using how people can use their body and their breath to relax themselves, to empower themselves, to release anxiety, fear, and pain. Fingers pointing up, inhaling from the nostrils to the belly, and exhaling again from your nostrils. Inhale from the nose. And when you're exhaling, you gently kind of tuck your chin into your chest. What this does is activate your throat chakra. The throat chakra is for assertiveness and talking and expressing your true feeling. From the belly, I don't see the belly's inflating. Other hand, left hand behind you, scratching your back. And pull your elbows together. That's it.
And then switch the other side.
Okay.
The other side.
Really good. That's really interesting. And just so talk
so
about
we, it. Yeah. So we went about 9 years after. Supposedly the war had ended, but yeah. There was no sign of the war, and that it felt like the war was there everywhere.
Uh-huh.
And then when we started doing the university, we started doing the workshops. No electricity.
Yeah.
No running water, no bathrooms.
Yeah, right.
So we had to pay for extra petroleum money,
mm-hmm.
so we can get the generators going, so we can have a little bit of PowerPoint, mm-hmm. show them the film and the model, and then have some fans because it was like 110 degrees in that room.
And humid.
And very humid.
Yeah, that's really.
And everything.
Not literally 110.
Not literally 106 maybe.
Oh, well, yeah. God, 106. I thought it was 110. I mean, I thought it was really, you know, I'm sorry. I'm just joking.
So, and the vans, burned cars, burned trees. Everything
horrible.
Is left as is.
Yeah.
There is no hope or inspiration to say, oh, okay, thank you know, the war is over. Let's try to put it together.
What was the war? Oh, go ahead.
The what they call the revolution. Revolutionary Front, the RUF, the militia, was just maiming and killing everyone.
What was the cause? What was it?
It's
what,
the greed
what is
about,
it the basis of this all?
It's about power,
power
greed,
and money.
Money, diamonds.
Yeah, money.
Right.
Yeah, blood diamonds. There's
and,
that film. Yeah,
yeah and the people haven't even seen a diamond
right.
or what it looks like.
Mm-hmm.
And they're using this. And they have turned their own people against one another. Where their own Sierra Leoneans.
Do you think that's what all the politics is about? Is
well,
nothing
it's
more
about,
than money?
It's about
it's money.
It's about weapon sales, war profiteering,
yes.
the banks that factor the manufacturing of weapons, so there's war profiteering. It's
and
a
it's
whole
the 1%.
Okay.
The 1% who have always
and
run the world and
right.
still do.
And their managers and their slaves.
And their manager and the people who are and all the people who are co-opted. By their ability to control
Except
everything.
Except that now people would rather stake everything. That's what the Occupy movement is about. All
I thought
world,
it was good
uprisings.
That they had this thing, the Occupy thing, May 1st. There was more response that I thought that there was, you know, because it was quiet after Mr. Bloomberg brought. He said he's got a 33,000-man army to occupy the Occupy movement, to nip it in its bud, and everything's under control, we're in control now, and everything's okay, just get back to voting for the president in the same way, and all the the whole institutional structures that we've inherited out of history are inadequate to a liberated order, which is
and
the promise
those,
of the moment. It's a time of qualitative transformation.
And,
yes.
and you know, what Bucky saw and so on is that the naturally regenerative universe can produce paradise and abundance for everyone.
Well,
so it's up to us and up to people like Dr. Kalayjian and institutions like the United Nations
mm-hmm.
and a transformed media and the kind of work that you're doing with the intelligent interesting conversations you're having, to assemble the elements and create models and make sure that lots of people know that there are solutions, there are models for a transformed planetary
culture. Why should there be a transformed planet when there never has been?
Because
why
this
will the
particular
planet,
moment...
What is there about this moment, or is there? That's a question you could ask. Is this just another couple decades of history, and we could look back 200,000 years, or is there something existentially or ontologically unique about this moment?
This moment,
this is 2012.
These months, that's
is
right.
Is there something?
There is.
If there is,
we believe
what
there is
unique?
I believe
about,
there
and
is.
I would say from this period, what is unique about this period? And for whatever reason, I would say since about 1970.
So,
what is unique? What is going on
Ani,
in terms
why don't you
of
take
the
that one? Why
because
don't you take that
evolution
one?
Is going. We come up out of Africa. 200,000 years, 10,000 generations, and we're saying this is the defining, and who, Isaac Asimov
all
said,
the,
this is the defining
all
generation.
All the prophecies.
And what kind of talk or thought is that relating to these larger issues? Why would we be thinking about trying to say, let's have some justice when we never have had it?
Because it's at the heart of all the great cultures. In their prophetic traditions, the ones that still remember them, and communicate them. It speaks of times of transformation, great shifts that are coming and will happen. And some of us believe that this is it now. We are in that time. And you're right, it didn't just start this year, but something is peaking this year. There's some alignment of thoughts and intentions and maybe cosmological alignments that impact the frequency of the earth that's going on. All these big earthquakes, the Sumatra tsunami, the magnetic pole shifted. When Haiti happened, the magnetic pole shifted further. So there's something that's going on.
Uh-huh. Yeah,
so
yeah.
Part of what Dr. Kalayjian's work does in Meaningful Worlds does, she's written a book about it.
Yes. What's that?
How you deal with traumas that come from human conditions and
trauma.
How you deal with traumas.
Yeah, when you get a chance, come in, Josh. No hurry. Go ahead.
Right.
Yeah. Go ahead. Keep talking. I'm sorry.
So certain kinds of traumas are created by the inhumanity of humans to humans. That needs certain type of interaction, forgiveness, healing, reparation. Other traumas come out of a tornado or an earthquake or something that comes over you that you have absolutely no way to mediate and control. So in her research, she has found that some modalities are the same and some are different to deal with this different type of trauma. So maybe she could talk a little about
that.
Let her talk
I can just say that you said what's different from 1970 to now.
No, this time, he said this is the defining generation, about 1970 to 2070. Mm-hmm. This period of time, is there something, not just another stage of history, there's something like speciation. We're coming to the end of 200,000 years of our existence. We're coming into, it's like punctuated equilibrium. It's like either, you know, and I'll just rant for a second. It's that one of the unique capabilities of the Homo sapiens species is not only self-reflective consciousness, where it can ask the larger issues of what's it all about, create creation stories and so forth, and political organization, but it's they have a unique capability to extend consciousness through what we call tools and technology.
Right.
And make the world other than in an Eden-like sense is the way most all creatures engage the environment. We were nested in nature, and then we can make it different. And so what's happened after civilization 8,000 years ago or so, when we got Neolithic agriculture surplus, we could build civilizations, Ur and so forth. And then what happened, you had a political class rose, and they would get armies together, and they would laud their inventors who could invent a weapon system that would give them an advantage to go conquer the other tribe, make their tribe strong. Everything's zero sum. There's not enough. The winners take all, that kind of thing. That kind of principle still rules the world. That's what rules the world.
So what has changed?
Let me make the point.
Well, let
me finish. I'm almost done. And so you take that weapon system, they became increasingly lethal.
Mm-hmm.
And they finally get to the point where by about In 1962, even at the time of the Cuban Missile Crisis, after special theory of relativity and whatnot, they had bombs. They could have wiped out civilization, but they could not wipe out the species. After 1970, by models, there are weapon systems that exist that if they're unleashed in a spasm of hatred, which has been our pattern and is still being reified by all of our data, that it's species lethal. We can wipe out the Homo sapiens species since about 1970. On the other side, the technologically augmented, good design capability of providing life support through technological extensions of our capability to provide for everyone, we were crossing the 50% mark in terms of world population trends. We were transcending material scarcity as an ontologic reality. Neither of those are ever mentioned in terms of that. But do we live in a world where we may be coming to the end of 200,000 years into a punctuated equilibrium? We're either going to liberate the whole of the human society, which never has been, and the ecology, mm-hmm. or we're going to stop evolution, we're going to annihilate it. That's only characteristic of this time. Second World War, we were infinite, and all time into history. Could you address some of that?
Yeah, and how does your type of operation?
Yeah, and how does your
trauma
thing? I
like to focus that since the 70s, there has been a new understanding of what trauma is and does.
Please.
That these wars are not just a triumph, because you have generations, seven generations of people traumatized, and then those who have been victims, they either become perpetrators and they create another war, like it happened in Rwanda with every 20 years, either Hutus will kill Tutsis or Tutsis will kill Hutus.
But hasn't that gone back through all of history?
That's what I'm saying.
So
since now there is the understanding
now?
that we cannot continue same old.
Yeah, but
we gotta learn from history, mm. and we got to change our actions.
No. If I may, we could have been.
Let her finish. What,
did you finish? Or can I make
finish.
A statement?
No, that's why.
Okay, we got to change
research,
our actions. Yeah,
yes,
okay.
Because the research shows that it's not about, okay, that's great, I'm the strong person now and I would kill people and then I win and then I am fine for the rest of my life or my children's life. That understanding is gone. It's old.
It's not only gone, it's running the world.
But
what is running it
some,
is
some talk, level please. On some level there is the consciousness since the 75 when the term PTSD post traumatic stress disorder came with the veterans coming back from Vietnam and they're totally incapable of functioning, being parent or child or husband or wife or anything. That's when the research showed that they were traumatized, and if they are not healed, they will not have a normal life. And that's why it was more and more we are bringing into people's consciousness that the same old game of war and greed and taking over is a short-term, if any, action, because it's affecting the next seven generations.
Well, that's
so what
seven
we need to learn.
She's sharing with you from her hands-on field experience.
I know.
She's answering your question.
Talk.
What we need to do is be mindful of what we're doing. Every single individual needs to be in check with their own heart and mind, the brain.
What you call self-reflective.
Yes, and try to live a decent life. Something that is based on United Nations Declaration of Human Rights. Yes, you have a right to have a house and to have a shelter and employment, but I do too. You can't kill me to get a job. That's not going to work in
1948.
Yeah. In the speech that you gave.
Yeah, but
let me mention something. Because I've been following your work and your thinking for a lot of years, because you and I come from some kind of similar genetic lineage and intelligence. Mm. So in your speech that you gave at the Humanist Society, you got to where we're really headed with all this technological augmentation is to a planetary culture where leisure is part of the things that's at the center, and where pleasure, the pleasure that you find when you share and you celebrate and you have gratitude. I mean, right now we're coming to the end, or we're coming to a crossroads that'll either end in extinction, planetary extinction. We have 435 nuclear power points all sitting on vulnerable places where tsunamis and tornadoes and whatever could create more Fukushimas. Fukushima is still spilling into the atmosphere and traveling everywhere, and it hasn't been stopped at that site. And we have Indian Point just up the river from us. That's the most vulnerable similar site here in North America. And Diablo Canyon in San Onofre in California looks exactly from the air like Fukushima. So we have built a Death Star here. What's it going to take to transform this? Specifically, how can we deal with the type of research and the type of tools that Dr. Kalayjian and Meaningful World and other organizations have discovered to help transform our self-reflectiveness, what yoga training can do, what flower remedies, meditation, exercise, how do we release all this trauma en masse? We have to do it en masse as well as one by one at a time to create a culture of peace, prosperity. So the UN all right?
Okay, do you make the point?
So the point is,
what?
Rather than ranting about what's wrong, we have to, I believe, really have the political, personal, emotional will, collective emotional will, the generosity, for instance, with which you shared your residence for collective meetings to look at solutions. That can spread as just as easily and with much more fun than the fear, than the lack, than the want that we've been programmed to.
Well,
I want to just focus on how your work.
Well, you put a whole lot out there and everything, and
in response to your putting a whole lot out.
All right, that's true enough and everything, but it seems to me they're completely different things. I mean, the people after the First World War with that trench warfare had post-traumatic stress syndrome. I think the people who survived the Civil War had this. This is something we've had. Nothing new about
it. But
Iraq.
It wasn't a relief.
It was like shell shock. It didn't give a name.
It was called shell shock or something like that. It wasn't studied scientifically.
But more importantly, the point different from that. That's history. That's all there is in history, is one people killing
the
other.
So we're here at this very moment, sitting here.
And always there have been people like you saying, let's be good. Let's be peaceful.
No.
Let's be happy. Let's be this and that. That's what you're saying.
Dear one, when you use that term correctly, self-reflexive, both personally as a community. We now have the science and the tools and the technology to begin to transform that age-old barbaric reptilian brain behavior.
Well, it's there. The reptilian core is
but
there.
But we now know enough about the brain, and we're learning more every day
about
how to transform that. So why don't you listen to a specialist here. You have a specialist here who's come to visit you today to tell you about how that can happen.
Well, I don't see anything in it. There's nothing different.
But are you able to quiet your own anxieties and mind enough just to listen? That's what a conversation
I've listened and everything. I don't see anything there.
All I can feel in watching you is you're like this yourself.
Yeah.
So why don't you let her share with you how they go about transforming these cultures? They go into these traumatized, shell-shocked, horrific things.
That's the earth.
No.
The difference, you've been talking and talking and talking. The difference between that time is that when the Hutus could kill the whole thing, the Germans could kill the French, the Americans could kill the Indians, they could not wipe out the species. Right. I'm trying to find something new. Say something new.
We understand. Can you hear us? I don't hear you.
No.
I don't feel
you. Don't hear that? You don't hear that? That's a difference?
We're trying to answer.
That's a difference.
My dear one.
What?
My dear one.
What's the difference?
Well, the difference is you're saying,
let's be good.
Let's be good. Let's be peaceful.
No, we don't say that.
Why?
I said,
what's different? Why can it happen now when it never has?
Arab, let's heal. Right. Well, how are you going? When you are not healed, you're going to go with fumes, like you're going now.
No.
You're going from anger. You're going
it's
from disappointment.
Anger.
Or
it's
disappointment.
Not anger. It's
disappointment, maybe.
No, what good
it's
is
fear
it?
Fear and grief.
What is different? What I'm asking, what's different? What makes it different now?
What?
That's what I'm asking.
We
not
now,
that Jesus
now,
said, take care of the least among you. Buddha said, take care of the least among you. All of that. Medici was happy with Leonardo because he invented siege machines. Right. The political class, it doesn't do any good to talk about let's be good
we're
and
not,
heal
we're not
and everything.
I agree with you.
And so what you got to get to is the question is, what's different about this time than all of history, rather than talking, let's listen to the great minds of history and let's be
well,
good.
Well, that's another hour's program.
What's different? The difference is destruction. We can wipe out the entire species, not the other tribe.
Right.
The other thing is,
Harold, the fact
that we have transcended material scarcity has nothing to do with peace and love
yes.
and all that.
Harold. Exactly.
It's Harold. A different Harold. Material reality.
We see the same Harold. Thing that
well, you won't let it be said.
You're telling me with
we
your
see,
shouting
I'm not
at
kidding.
Me now.
We
you
see.
Are annihilating me. With your
well, you are lying me. You are annihilating me with your ignorance.
I'm begging you to allow her to communicate with you.
Yeah, what are you saying?
Stop,
let her talk.
We notice that this is happening. We agree
with you. What notice what?
We agree with you that we're in... killing each other.
Not killing each other. We've always done that.
No,
we stop evolution. It's not the same. This is not the same as all of the anger of history or trauma of history.
But he's saying
what
has been so agitated is we have a chance to annihilate the entire planet.
Yes, we do.
No, stop
every
evolution. That's new. That's new. What's comparable on the other side? Why isn't it worth mentioning? Nothing to do with love or anything like that. A material reality. Materialistic.
Right.
We have transcended scarcity.
Right.
There is enough. Mm-hmm. There never has been enough. There is enough. We have enough to feed and take care of everybody
someplace.
In the ecology. Why is it never mentioned rather than saying, let's be good? They've been saying that
that's
for 2,000 years.
That's not what we're saying. That's
it sounds to me like that's what you're saying. And heal
can
from
you,
all the
can
bullshit.
Can
maybe
a few deep breaths?
Theoretically, maybe we have enough about
no, not theoretically.
But
it
in
is
Sierra
not.
Leone, there are people dying of hunger in Haiti.
Oh, I'm not saying the reality.
Right.
No, but
well,
don't
okay,
you.
So now we
let's
heard,
focus.
Frustrating
now
we heard
you
your cry of grief. We've been listening to your cry of grief for the last
yes.
10 minutes.
It's not a cry of grief.
Please, can you just take deep breaths and listen while she tries to answer what you're saying?
Okay.
We get that we could destroy everything in an instant.
No, yes. not that much so much. We have transcended scarcity,
I agree.
Materialistic,
I
nothing
agree.
To do
okay.
with love.
Can you take a deep okay. breath and let her respond?
One of the ways...
It's never mentioned.
Three deep breaths and let her respond.
One of the ways that we are trying to address the situation now, we recognize that people are wounded. There are walking wounded people. That's why decisions are not made from the love and forgiveness, and it's made from greed, from scarcity, even though there is enough, but people still...
No, don't say that! It has not been enough. It was scarce until that time, just yesterday. It was scarcity, it was real, ontologically. It is no longer real. It should be addressed without love or any of these kind of things you appear, good guys, bad guys. That is never addressed seriously. That's my point. That's why I'm angry. That's the means by which we can get and maybe it liberate the whole thing rather than annihilate it. And it's never mentioned. You don't mention it. All you do is talk about love and healing.
Well, we can talk only on the psychological and the emotional and the spiritual needs that we address. I can't talk about the nuclear weapons and annihilating humanity because that's not my area of specialty.
Oh, you're special.
So my specialty is on really addressing the needs of collective human beings who have suffered both direct trauma and generational trauma.
Okay.
And how we see, like Sierra Leone, like Haiti.
Yeah, we got
like
another.
Like also the Democratic Republic of Congo.
It's everywhere.
They keep going the same cycle.
Well, yeah, well, we're going to keep going. Listen, one of the things is
something?
I'm ranting.
But
you shouldn't rant.
Let me mention something, please.
Well, I've got to get the other DVD.
We do, but let me mention something. 9-1-1 World Trade Towers, 3,000 people died, under 3,000 died. That many die of hunger every single
Thank you, I'm
hour.
Aware of that. I'm okay. aware, needlessly,
calm,
now.
Calm, mm-hmm. please. I've never seen you this agitated. I know you're concerned about these things. There are levers, there are mechanisms. It's getting enough people trained in working with them and using them and knowing how to transform the political mechanisms. Right now we have this 99% and 1% desired disaggregation of the aspect, the access to tools and resources. Everything has to be turned around.
There Thank
are,
you.
There are tools and
Why?
Why what?
Why change now when it never has been?
Because several things. One, we have the tools to do it with
now.
Men. Yes.
Okay. Some consciousness some, also.
We have
some
evolving awakening. Consciousness. More and more people are waking up and changing how they behave. The people who are sitting on the levers of power, too many of them still haven't awoken. Some of their children have, and they maybe are working on their parents. There's opportunity. There's also a much larger cosmological thing that's happening. Bucky mm-hmm. stood on the edge of that lake and asked his universal intelligence, I feel like a failure. Help me make a contribution.
That was in 27.
That's right.
Yeah, that's a long time ago.
No, right? But many people have done that now through meditation, well, through therapy, through collective activities together.
Let a couple of atomic tipped or weapons go over into Iran from Israel, and then we're drug in, and then the others. There's nothing to do with rational. The weapons could be, at any moment, could be unleashed. And then the point is, it's never mentioned this thing, what makes the difference, and it exists at a level of capability.
We know, we've already said
transcended
that.
Scarcity.
I know, but
there
word,
is enough.
The word hasn't gotten out yet.
Why?
So it's up to
Because you don't ever
no,
bring it up.
No, because it's up to us.
It's
to,
not law
it's
or
up,
anything like
it's
that.
It's all of that.
Okay.
It's up to us to bring it out. Can we roll the tape from
Well,
Haiti?
We got, it's
so
51 out of 58.
Haiti?
Yeah, and you got a tape from where?
Haiti.
From Haiti.
Right.
So, Josh.
Our first team.
Can you set up the tape from Haiti, perhaps? And then we could run that. That's about another 3 minutes. Another yeah. place where all the same old baloney is going on, and there's nobody, no intellectual anyway, talking about
it's
things relevant.
65 to 68% have moderate to high levels of post-traumatic stress disorder, and others, especially children, have a lot of conduct behavior issues because they don't have a school, they're hanging out in the street, and they're losing their discipline. They're hitting one another very much. We're working with 60 children each day since we've been here, 50 to 60 children each day. We do art therapy, play therapy, and we help, we give them gloves and garbage bags so that they can clean around the hospital and be part of the solution to beautify the environment, right? My question is, when do you think the schools will open, even if it's intense? Because I think the sooner the schools open, they will go to their schools and get back to their discipline, and the parents start addressing their domestic needs.
If my school, they don't have a lot of problems, it's open.
Right.
But another one is wait until the government gives some help.
Some.
Because yes, we need some materials, some equipment to take off the degrees.
Yes.
And some help also to pay the teachers or something like that. And most of the families, you know, they don't have home, they don't, the children lose all these, you know, books, pencil, things like that. So they need some help, so they're waiting for the government until that's the government help. So officially the school will be open on April.
Nous bien une organisation humanitaire qui ensemble avec nous là. C'est Meaning for Work, c'est ça?
Meaning for World.
Meaning for Work, et yo passe ouais nous là, et les amis ou même qui est avec nous, est-ce qu'on a dit qui ça qui mène nous là?
The association is called Association for Trauma Outreach and Prevention. We call it ATA for short.
C'est une organisation pour trauma.
And the goal is to try to come and help the emotional wounds, heal the emotional wounds of the survivors here after the earthquake.
C'est pour ça les venir pour les des monde qui gagne blessure avec tremblement de terre, monde qui peut entrer dans béton, c'est ça ils viennent régler, c'est peut-être ça ils viennent même ici c'est pour
This is the circle of love. Trust. and unity.
Okay, c'est ça que l'amour, l'unité et croyance, c'est ça.
Okay,
bye. Bye. Chest. Now one arm.
Was really good. I hope we got all that in. That yes. was in Haiti, right?
Yes.
So
yes.
there's another place where it's horrible. The living conditions are horrible, deteriorating, and it's very, very disquieting. It's good you're doing something to help within the
right.
situation.
Right.
It's
to answer your
utter
question,
poverty.
What's interesting about Haiti is there's continuing a lot of attention there. Haiti is 1,000 square miles. It's small. It's human scale. It's, mm. it's 10 million people.
Mm-hmm.
Haiti could be brought back as a paradise. It suffered this huge, devastating earth change.
Yeah, a terrible right? earthquake.
So it's a poster country that actually is doable, and then you could take what you do there and transfer all of those technologies.
Mm-hmm.
So Dr. Kalayjian's work and Meaningful World's work is what I call the soft technology.
Mm-hmm.
Even if you built gorgeous hospitals and beautiful new homes and reforested the whole country and cleaned up the agriculture and so on and had decent politicians in place, 10 million people who've been traumatized would recreate the problem over again if they don't get the kind of soft technology that Dr. Kalayjian and her many peers around the world are working on.
Very good. And this sort of work should be done, and congratulations
right.
on the work.
I
and
wanted
all of
to
that.
Also mention that the next projects, the end of May, uh-huh. Meaningful World is going to, invited by East Jerusalem University there to do special workshops on forgiveness and reconciliation on this topic.
Okay, let's show this book. This, is, not, this is your book?
Yes.
Peter? Okay, let's show this one too. We can get it in here at the end. We got a minute or
and
so left.
And June 15, we go back to Haiti, and the end of June, we go to Democratic Republic of Congo, Rwanda, and Kenya.
You could go almost anywhere in the world, including New York.
And we need sponsorship. We do trainings here in New York as well.
Yeah, hey, they got the book now. Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's the whole world, and it's the whole world, and it's the 1%. Are you in support of the Occupy movement? Is that something that resonates to you? You think it's a good idea, or is it just
idealistic thing? But let's stick with these missions.
Yes.
Well,
so, what is needed is sponsorships for scholarships to take professionals, to train professionals in these countries that are recovering from trauma like nothing we've seen here.
Right, it's something really horrible.
Professionals are putting their volunteer time, so if donors interested, $3,000 would be enough to sponsor a professional to go to Africa with us to do the work.
Mm-hmm.
And so there are also we have a sponsor a child project because education is paid. You have to pay for education in Haiti and Africa. So we have what the Educate a Child project, where $350 you can educate a child the whole year.
Okay.
So we have these incentives.
Have you got a place where they can get in touch with you to volunteer
or support? Meaningfulworld.com.
Meaningfulworld.com.
Yes.
And then you could help support their work, and you've been able to get that across.
Exactly.
And you could use support for your very good work.
Exactly.
Okay, thank you. I hope
thank
it works.
You so
and then
much.
We'll continue to talk with you about this larger
Well, I'll go
scope.
Off somewhere else because that's not my way of thinking.
No, but...
No, I'll go somewhere
you
else. That doesn't appeal
questions.
To me at all.
You raise the correct questions and it all integrates.
Well,
mm-hmm.
I hope
mm-hmm. promise you.
I hope you can get a lot of support for your project and everything and there's everybody trying to get
support.
And that
we can scale
support.
This project to the questions you're raising. You see, the questions you're raising are... The meaningful questions. That's why the organization is called Meaningful World.
Yeah, well, that's a good title, isn't it? Okay,
can we high five on all of that, too?
Yeah, of course.
Give me your hand there.
Congratulations on the work, Don. Yeah, okay, we're coming
back.
Thank you. So come back. I think we're probably out by now, but we're coming back. And thanks a lot for the work.
I want to give these to you to take home.
Yes, these are for you.
Oh, okay, thanks.